funded in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
I'm Jim Whaley. It's a great pleasure to welcome to the Cinema Showcase one of our most prominent filmmakers, director John Carpenter. His first major film, Halloween, established his reputation, and his latest motion picture is Starman, starring Jeff Bridges. We'll have a scene from Starman to show you, so join me as I talk with John Carpenter on this Cinema Showcase. Thank you very much for joining Cinema Showcase, and join me right now in welcoming John Carpenter. John, good to see you.
Good to see you.
First of all, I want to congratulate you on your film, Starman.
Well, thank you.
It's an unusual motion picture because it has so many different qualities. I don't think people, when they hear the name Starman, will immediately know just what they're in for, really. How would you best describe the film? I know it's a terrible thing to ask a filmmaker to describe his own film, but how would you categorize this film?
Primarily, I think it's a science fiction love story at its basis. When I read the screenplay, I thought here was a chance to do It Happened One Night, a kind of an updated version with a science fiction premise to it. So that's what I did.
When you made Halloween, and that was such a tremendous success, were you at all concerned that you would be forever typecast?
I made Halloween in 1978, and immediately after I finished it, before the film was released, I started doing Elvis, the three-hour TV movie. I was hired to do Elvis because I had done Halloween, because the people who were producing Elvis thought I knew how to handle music, and Elvis was about music. When Halloween first came out, it received terrible reviews all across the country. Everybody reviewed it as being a really awful exploitation horror movie. So I sort of wrote Halloween off until it was re-reviewed by the Village Voice, and it kind of, a new wave of reviews said it was good again. And by that time, I was making another film, so it was a strange experience. People kept coming up to me and saying, you know, Halloween, Halloween, and I'd already forgotten about it. Mm-hmm. It had already been reviewed badly. And all of a sudden, I found myself sort of typed as a maybe the new Hitchcock for a while. Well, thank God that didn't happen, because that's the last thing you want to have to struggle under, is trying to be somebody like Hitchcock. Mm-hmm. You can't do it, for sure. Mm-hmm. And I knew when I came to film school and when I came into Hollywood that I could do any kind of a movie. I could do love stories and westerns and war movies and what have you. And it's just a question of being hired to do the right film. And I think Starman, luckily for me, was a chance to do a romantic comedy. And I'm really excited about it.
But for better or worse, your more profitable films, I suppose, up to this point, have been those films that have been in the suspense genre, haven't they?
Thrillers, action pictures, mm-hmm. suspense films, yeah. And Halloween, The Fog, and Escape from New York, and The Thing, and those kinds of films, which I love dearly. I love those kinds of movies, and always have and always will. But that's not the only thing I can do. And hopefully Starman will help prove that.
Yeah. When you were thinking about the casting for Starman, did Jeff Bridges come immediately to mind?
Not at first. The casting of Starman came about kind of backwards, because I went to New York to interview actors, and I met Karen Allen, and all of a sudden I knew that's Jenny Hayden. She had this quality about her, which I found her extremely beautiful to look at, and really, really fascinating. I couldn't take my eyes off of her eyes and her face. She has a very... She projects a truthfulness and honesty about her in everything she does. And I felt that the character of Jenny Hayden had to be extremely honest and truthful in all her reactions. Well, then who could play opposite Karen Allen? I interviewed several people and finally came to Jeff. And met Jeff. And there was something about Jeff, and I went back and looked at some of his films. He is a physical actor. All of his characterizations have something physical about them. He's different in every one of them. He's not a typical Hollywood movie star. And I thought maybe there's a danger if we cast somebody who's really well known as Starman. Richard Gere as Starman. I don't know if it would work. Not that Richard Gere isn't a good actor, but I think the audience needs not identify him with a big star. So mm-hmm. Jeff was just right, and Jeff was also brave enough to try it. So off we went.
He has been called in films an American innocent.
That's pretty good. He has a quality to him that, but Jeff personally is a real sweet man. He's kind of an old hippie from the old days. He still has sort of peace and love in him, you know. And that kind of comes out in his characters. Even when he was playing the football player in Against All Odds, there was something about him that you really liked to watch. I think the camera loves him, too. Mm-hmm. Loves to watch him.
Yeah.
Which is a sign of any great actor has that, I think, any great movie actor.
You know, I think that's it's one of the reasons that people give for the failure of, the movie he made year before last, Kiss Me Goodbye, in which he was cast against type as the one character in the piece you really weren't supposed to like.
Mm.
And audiences wouldn't accept him in that kind of role. So, therefore, they say that's why the picture failed. Yeah, there's something about him that you instinctively like.
I think so, yeah. Of course, I think Jeff would love to play villains, and he may do one. You may wait and see.
Be a very effective, probably.
Yeah, I think so.
We have a scene from your film that I'd like to show. What do we need to know about this this clip? What leads up to it?
Well, this is Jenny and Starman are driving across country, and this is a certain point in the journey of their first day. And Starman is learning about the Earth. He's learning that the car needs gasoline. And at the beginning of this scene, he's learning that the human body needs food. And he's driving the car, and he's learned how to drive by watching Karen Allen. So we'll sort of start from there.
Yeah, should we say that he is, first of all, an extraterrestrial.
That's right.
Who has somehow wound up on Earth.
That's right. And okay. He's cloned himself to look exactly like Karen Allen's dead husband.
Mm-hmm.
And so here they go.
All right. Here's a scene right now from John Carpenter's film Starman.
Did you ever get hungry? Empty here. Like a car needs gas?
Yes. This body has a terrible emptiness. This is called hungry.
Yeah, and when people get hungry, they have to eat food.
Eat. Yes, we must do that. We will stop at food station. You have hungry too.
I'm starving. I haven't eaten since.
Oh my God! Who goes out? What are you doing?
I do know the rules.
Oh, well, for your information, pal, that was a yellow light back there.
I watched you very carefully. Red light stop, green light go, yellow light go, very fast.
A scene from Starman, directed by my guest, John Carpenter. John, in making this film, or making any film, is it essential when you begin a project to have a complete idea in your own mind as to where you're going to take everything? Now, what I mean by that is, halfway through during the shooting, could you happen upon a different set of circumstances that would lead you in a different direction as to where the film might go? Has that ever happened?
When I read a screenplay or I write a screenplay, the first element of it that I respond to is if I can see the movie. For instance, when I read Starman, I could see the film. I could see it in my mind. And then just went out and made the film that I saw. Screenplays that I read that I don't make are the ones that I can't see any visuals in them.
Mm-hmm.
No, the script is pretty much a Bible for me. That's what we go by. That's the blueprint of the movie. You know, that's the story that's told. And you read it on paper and you agree to it on paper. And then you go out and make that film. The problem comes sometimes if you try to change something out in the boondocks when you're shooting, and what seems like a good idea at 4 in the morning on a kind of a cold night may not seem quite so great when you get back into the screening room and right. you look at it and say, oh, why did I let them do that? So that's why you stick with your script.
Yeah. Now, that does not mean you're not open to contributions or improvisations or whatever from your actors.
Oh, absolutely. Now, I encourage improvisation and taking a scene in maybe a different direction, adding colors to a scene. Now, that's just part of making a film.
Mm-hmm.
But to change the meaning of a scene or to change the plot or to change something really basic to the story, no, I don't think so. I don't believe in that.
It would seem to me, though, that the suspense genre would be the type of film that would least likely lend itself to change, because it depends on certain things happening at certain points in order to get the whole message across, if you follow me.
So that's why suspense is so difficult to do, because it's constructed. You start with the story, and you construct the story in such a way to create suspense in the audience's mind. Well, then when you film it, you have to film it a certain way. You can't film it another way, because it won't be suspenseful.
Mm-hmm.
That's very technical and very difficult to do, and oftentimes it's frustrating, because there's some magic that takes place when you're constructing a suspense story that just makes it click, or sometimes it doesn't.
Well, now when you say you see things in a visual sense when you're reading the script, does that mean you're already plotting out the camera angles and so forth?
I pretty much don't think in terms of angles when I read a script. I try to read a script as if I was seeing the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And so I was sitting in a dark theater, and there's a screen up there, and the lights go down, and the movie starts, and I'll start reading the script. And if it's suddenly I can see the film and I'm wrapped up in it as I'm reading it, then I say, well, that's for me, let's go.
Because, you know, there are those directors, and it, to this day it puzzles me how they were able to function, but there were some brilliant directors who were able to write a script, storyboard the whole thing, and not, to my knowledge, change anything on the set. Hitchcock worked that way, apparently, with very little input from his actors. And yet, who can deny the brilliance of Hitchcock's films?
Some of them weren't. I think that's been overrated in terms of him. You know that when they were doing North by Northwest, Cary Grant, Hitchcock gave him enormous control over the character and changing lines.
Hmm.
And if you read, they've published the screenplay to North by Northwest. If you read the original screenplay and read it against what they shot, there's big differences in there. So I don't think that that's quite true from Hitchcock's point of view. I think he liked to put that out as part of his image. I know that there was a lot of publicity at the time when they were making Raiders of the Lost Ark. Every shot was storyboarded, and they shot just those storyboards. And the movie looks like it to me. It really looks like it's planned. Every shot is looks like a drawing.
Yeah, does this bother you? Or?
I became aware of it after a while, and I became aware of being sort of manipulated, slightly. It worked. It was mm-hmm. fun, and it's enjoyable. It's like reading a comic book, you know. You see every frame drawn out. But I feel like for every film, that's not a good idea, because some films you want to feel a sense of reality and a sense of spontaneity, and you lose that when you storyboard. In other words, you move a camera and you say, well, I've got to have this particular angle. This is the only one that will do, and you fight and you fight and you get it. Sometimes it's flat because you've drawn it. Sometimes it's better to just watch something from a distance and come in and say, well, let's do it like this, or let's put the camera up here and looking down, or let's get back away and look for it. Do it on the spot. That's what I've tried to do more and more. Just kind of shoot from the hip when you're out there.
Mm-hmm. I suppose from a pyrotechnical point of view, your most difficult movie was probably The Thing, because you had to work with so many special effects. Now, in making a film like that, it would be necessary almost to choreograph these type things.
You had to. And yet, no matter how much we drew pictures of what was going to happen, we would get to the set to shoot it, and it's not what it appears to be. The Thing, doing the monster in The Thing was like a radio show. You had to suggest so much, because what was really there wasn't there. By that I mean it didn't look real. We had to use shadows and sounds, and people talk about how explicit it was. It really wasn't. It was in your mind that it was explicit, because what's on the screen is a bunch of rubber moving around and being pulled by strings and puppeted like this. But it's a lot of camera angles and lighting that go into making it look kind mm-hmm. of realistic. Yeah.
I agree, but you know, even those critics who had previously championed most of your work said that very thing about the thing, that perhaps it was too explicit.
It was in their minds, though. See, yeah. That's a fascinating thing to me. I think The Thing was a very pessimistic film, and one of the problems with it was a relentless film in terms of what it was saying. It was talking about the evil from within, and it came out at the same time E.T. came out, and E.T. is about sort of Lassie from the sky who comes down, and it's a very charming and wonderful little story. And The Thing is the exact opposite of it. It's saying you can't trust anybody and you can't win. It mm-hmm. will kill you. I don't feel like audiences really wanted to see that at that time, which is unfortunate.
I assumed you had watched, of course, the Howard Hawks production of The Thing. There's always been a controversy, and maybe you can settle it for me, about who actually directed the Hawks version of The Thing. Did Hawks actually direct it, or did the credited director? Was it Christian Nyby?
Christian Nyby was Howard Hawks' editor for many years. He did Red River and he did several other things. And Hawks was down at SC. And I saw him down there in 1971, and I asked him who had directed it. And at the time, he said, no, Christian Nyby directed this. I gave him a few suggestions, but so on. Over the years, his story sort of changed, and he took more and more credit for having directed it. It's so much a Hawks film, mm-hmm. with the overlapping dialogue and the camera angles. I would be real surprised. I've seen other work of Mr. Nyby's also, and it doesn't seem to have the same consistency. So
yeah.
It's just a guess.
Who among the Hollywood veterans would be your favorite filmmakers?
Well, my favorite director, who we just talked about, is Howard Hawks. he's influenced my career probably more than my work, more than anybody else. John Ford, Louis Buñuel, who recently just died. Some of them more, Orson Welles.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the more modern guys, I really like Roman Polanski. I think he's the best living film director we have right now. Primarily Hawks, Ford, not Hitchcock quite as much. I feel like he did some brilliant work, but I feel like also he did some work. Of course, all of them did work. Everybody does work.
I'm glad you mentioned Hawks, because he's a particular favorite of mine, not that the others are not. But above and beyond everything, I think Hawks was a magnificent storyteller.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I suppose there's a book out called Howard Hawks.
Storyteller yeah.
Right. But he he did wonderful things with the camera. He did wonderful technical things, yet they were all subservient to the story.
They call him the invisible technician.
Mm-hmm.
The camera
that bothers some people, that they can't see the flashy dynamics. You know.
But the camera was always in the right place for a scene. It shouldn't be over this way a little bit. It shouldn't be over that way a little bit. It was always right. And you look at some of his films, they're magical.
Yeah.
Because he put the camera at his own eye level. It was just the way Howard Hawks stood to watch a scene. He put it right here. And it was brilliant stuff. His action stuff is some of the best.
Mm-hmm. You have a favorite Hawks film?
My favorite movie of all time, the one I could watch over and over and over again, is Rio Bravo. I think that incorporates all sorts of things that are great about Hawks.
Mm-hmm.
His comedy, his action, and so forth.
You know, I think that is probably, True Grit aside, John Wayne's best performance.
Maybe
that
and
Red River.
The Searchers is pretty hot, yeah. Wayne did a lot of great films.
Yeah. Walter Brennan, too, in Rio Bravo. Mm-hmm. With
Dean Martin in Rio Bravo. Angie Dickinson in Rio Bravo.
In case you're tuning in, this is the Howard Hawks tribute with John Carpenter. You have made so many excellent films that I want to spend some time on. Escape from New York is one I particularly enjoy. First of all, what were New Yorkers' reactions to this movie?
Well, I think a lot of them found it kind of funny, which was supposed to be. Initially, when we were shooting the Statue of Liberty sequence in New York, we had a lot of New Yorkers who were very hostile about it. They're very defensive about seeing New York as a kind of a prison with a lot of... Actually, a lot of New Yorkers said, I would describe the plot of the film, they said, that's not science fiction, that's what it's like right now. They're a little defensive.
But Kurt Russell was, I think, superb in that film.
He was good.
And you had worked with him previously.
We did Elvis
together.
Yeah.
And there are a whole crop, if I can use that word, of younger actors who are consistently good. We were talking about Jeff Bridges. He's always good. Who have yet to reach that plateau of stardom that they really should. And it makes you wonder what's holding them back. Or
just the picture. I think it's just the right picture to be in. John Wayne didn't become a big star till Stagecoach. And then he renewed his career again with Red River. You know, it's the picture that does it, and sometimes it's not the best one that they've done.
Yeah.
But the audience is funny. They forget sometimes. They forget faces and pictures and movies, and all of a sudden it'll click with one. It's like Michael Jackson's career, for instance. All of a sudden he's this giant phenomenon, and he's been around for years doing very good work. But why all of a sudden does he go like that?
Yeah. Let me get back to Halloween for a moment. You had mentioned when the picture first came out, it was not appreciated. It was only a while later. When you made Halloween, did you know that you had made... Are you a good judge of your own work, first of all?
Do you mean commercially, or how do you mean that, judge of my work?
Well, let's say commercially. After you've made a film, do you have a good sense of whether or not it will take off at the box office?
No, my experience is that you go out and you make the best film you can make. You tell the story the best you can tell it. And the elements that go into making a box office hit are fairly mysterious to everyone. If I knew and everybody at the studios knew, everybody would be making hit after hit. Every film would be a hit. I don't think anybody knows 100%, some better than others.
All right, how do you account then for the fanatical following that Halloween has since gained?
How do I account for it? Because I think it worked for what it was. It was supposed to be a roller coaster ride. It was supposed to be a horror movie that finally scared you. And I updated some old haunted house techniques, basically. The old hand that comes out and taps you on the shoulder stuff. And played with audience expectations, and I think it just came along at the right time. Had that movie come later or earlier, it might not have worked as well. Lucky timing.
Part of the key, I think, too, at least for me, was the fact that a lot of it was what was not seen, the expectation of what was about to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that goes back to, I suppose, some of the Val Lewton films in the 40s.
Val Lewton, even before then, some James Whale and Frankenstein.
Exactly.
Real early stuff, yeah.
What about the subsequent Halloween films? Were you, once you had done Halloween, were you at all tempted to say, no more Halloween?
Well, I said that for quite a while. And there are two sides to one when you work in the movie business. One is as an artist, or you think of yourself as a creative person. And the other side is a business person. And I let my producer side come out when they offered me the sequels to Halloween. They offered a nice sum of money, and I also had a lot of hope for giving new directors a chance to make films as I had been given a chance with low budget films. And the directors who did 2 and 3, Rick Rosenthal and Tommy Wallace, were what they were given was a budget, and in some cases a script, and okay, here are the rules of the game, make your movie, then nobody's going to bother you. It doesn't always work. I thought Halloween 3 was excellent. I really like that film because it's different. It has a real nice feel to it. I think he's a talented director. On the other hand, I think Halloween 2 is an abomination and a horrible movie. I was really disappointed in it. But I don't think the director has gone on and done some other films. I think his career is launched now. But I don't think he had a feel for the material. Yeah. I think that's the problem. He didn't have a feeling for what was going on.
And that is vital.
Oh, yeah.
Getting back to Starman, there have been already some vague comparisons to E.T., in that the Jeff Bridges character is a sort of earthly E.T. or whatever. How do you answer that? Do you agree with that? Or
I think it's inevitable because it's a positive Visitor from Outer Space movie. There haven't been many of them. Even Day the Earth Stood Still had Gort, who was a little dangerous in it. But it's all right with me if people compare it that way. Again, I see it as much more of an old-fashioned road comedy. I think it's more like a 1930s or 40s film. It reminds me of the Depression films that
Capra
made, mm-hmm. and also like Sullivan's Travels. It reminds me a little of the feel of that, what the feeling is out on the road and the kind of people in America.
Well, I think we can say that it's the antithesis, really, of The Thing, in that it is a very positive, a very optimistic film. And when you leave the theater, you leave feeling good.
Even though the ending is not entirely optimistic,
right.
in a sense. It's
Let's say you leave feeling fulfilled, satisfied, whatever.
That's right. That's right. And it is. It's the opposite of The Thing. It's just another point of view of things.
Yeah. This has been a fast half hour. I hope you've enjoyed it, and I want to wish you much success with
thank
your
you.
Movie Star Man. It's a fine film, and thank you for being here.
Thank you. I enjoyed it.
Thank you. My thanks to all of you for watching. Until next time, good night.
This belongs to the real king of the quarry.
This is for you, Papa.
Thanks.
Who's that?
That's the photographer from the Bloomington News.
His father heard about Bloomington, Colin.
The Bloomington News? Wait a second. Wait a second! How much you want for that picture?
Breaking Away will continue in a moment.
Tomorrow on Charlie's Angels, Farrah Fawcett joins a dating service to trace a missing man, but she could be on her way to a date with death. Then the inspiring story of the extraordinary woman who became America's first saint. Kate Mulgrew stars as Mother Seton in A Time for Miracles. Now stay tuned as two lovely women scheme to reunite a feuding father and son on a festive Christmas cruise.